Able to preach for a few minutes on this Palm Sunday. This is Palm Sunday, what we recognize it as such. I don't know that this is the exact day or anything like that, but this is what we celebrate. It's Palm Sunday, that 5 days before the death of Jesus, the week there before his crucifixion. And that's what we now call this, is Palm Sunday. Matthew chapter 21 will be taking our text from. Matthew 21. And when you get there, if you're able to stay, I'm going to ask you to stand for the reading of God's word. We're going to look at verses 1 through 11 of Matthew chapter 21. And here the Bible says, "And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem, and were come unto Bethpage, unto the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus 2 disciples, saying unto them, Go into the village over against you, and straightway ye shall find an ass tied, and a colt with her. Loose them, and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, you shall say, The Lord has need of them, and straightway he will send them. All this was done, that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell ye the daughter of Zion, Behold, the king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass, and a colt, the foal of an ass. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. And the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he was come unto the Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? And the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning, Lord. Lord, just keep me out of the way today, Lord. Let you be visible and seen and heard. God, may you do a mighty work through your word this morning. Help us, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. Very familiar text of Scripture. I'm 50 years old, and I guess I've been in church about every year in 50 years I know of. I know I have, but heard this message preached. A lot. I've heard it taught on a lot. I've read it a lot. I don't want us to get the familiarity of it to let us just think, well, here's another old message on Palm Sunday. I want us to see what God has to say about this and why the significance of it. Why he even had it in his word. He inspired every word in this Bible. It's true. He wants us to know about it. And so it's in here for a reason. And so, as I said, as we read this, this is known as the Triumphal Entry. We refer to it as Palm Sunday today. All four Gospels record this event. And it happened approximately 5 days before Jesus was crucified. And the events leading up to this, Jesus had been there in the area in Jericho, actually. And he was making his way to Jerusalem because he knew the time was come. You know, all along, Jesus knew the time was coming. And he kept telling his disciples the time was coming. The time has come when they will take and crucify me. Although they didn't quite understand it, he kept telling them. But the events leading up to this, he was over in Jericho. He restored sight to blind Bartimaeus. We all remember that great story. And then he brought salvation to Zacchaeus, the little short man sitting up in the tree. And he went and ate lunch with him, and that man got saved. And then he traveled on into Bethany, right there before he got to Jerusalem, and visited the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, the one that he raised from the dead. His good friends, he went there quite often and enjoyed being with them. And then he headed toward Jerusalem by the way of Bethpage and under the Mount of Olives. Now, this will be the last week of the Lord's life here on this earth before he's betrayed, taken, put on a mock trial, beaten, and crucified. And so a lot of things happened on that way. Look at verse 1. It said, "And when they drew nigh unto Jerusalem and were come to Bethpage under the Mount of Olives, then sent Jesus 2 disciples. The Mount of Olives is high up on a hill overlooking all of in the east of Jerusalem, about a mile from the city of Jerusalem. 2,600 feet in elevation. It's real tall, up high. And you can see the entire city from up there. Jesus spent a lot of time up there. We see where there he gave the discourse there on Mount Olivet. That's where we're talking about, the Mount of Olives, Mount Olivet. It's there where it's believed that Jesus ascended and went into heaven to sit on the right hand of the Father. And it's there where we believe, according to the Scriptures, that he will come again, and his feet will be there in the Mount of Olives. Over in Zechariah 14 and 4, the Bible says, "And his feet shall stand in that day upon the Mount of Olives, which is before Jerusalem on the east. And the Mount of Olives shall cleave in the midst thereof toward the east and toward the west. And there shall be a very great valley, and half the mountain shall remove toward the north and half of it toward the south. Talking about the return of the Son of Man, of Jesus Christ, says that's where he's going to come and plant his feet. Look at verse 2. It says, saying unto them, his disciples, meaning his disciples, go into the village over against you, and straightway you shall find an ass tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them unto me. And if any man say aught unto you, you shall say, the Lord has need of them, and straightway he will send them. And this was done that it might be fulfilled, which is spoken by the prophet, saying, tell you the daughter of Zion, behold, the king cometh unto thee, meek and sitting upon an ass and a colt, the foal of an ass. Jesus sends his two disciples. Most believe it to be Peter and John. The Bible doesn't say that. Probably was. They were there, part of the inner circle. Peter, James, and John were always around. And it's probably those two. We know they were talked about much during the crucifixion and toward the end of Jesus' life. John was the only disciple that talks about being there at the foot of the cross when Jesus was being crucified, and he gave the care of his mother over to John, the beloved. And Peter, of course, we all know his story as he followed behind and watched things unroll as he betrayed Christ, or as he denied Christ three times. He didn't betray him, but he denied him three times. And so these two were probably the two disciples he sent. Now, he did all this, according to the scripture, was because it would fulfill prophecy. And the Bible even interpreted itself there about the prophecy coming from the Old Testament. And so this whole section of Jesus' ascent into Jerusalem, that triumphal entry, as we call it, this is all fulfilling of many, many scriptures. I believe I found about 48 different references to Old Testament scriptures, a prophecy that was given that's fulfilled during this time. And so it's very important in the life of Jesus. And it was all done according to God's timetable. Now, if you remember when Jesus was there and he was feeding the multitudes, this is before all this, and he was out there and he fed the multitudes with all the fishes and loaves of bread. And after he got done, they all wanted to immediately make him their king. And remember, he had to actually escape from them and get out of their midst because they were going to force him to be their king. And so they wanted to do that because of all the miracles he'd done. And they assumed, well, this man, he's so great and he can do all these things. He can surely overtake Rome and come and be our king and be our leader. But Jesus said it was not his time. Now is his time. Everything that God does is on a certain timetable. And it's not our timetable. But the Bible, as I mentioned, interprets itself. And it's talking about the Old Testament prophetic scripture over in Zechariah again. We've been talking about Zechariah a lot lately. My Sunday school class, we're studying Revelation, and we keep referring back to Zechariah's prophecies. But here in Zechariah 9:9, it says, rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, the king cometh unto thee. He is just and having salvation lowly and riding upon an ass and upon a colt, the foal of an ass. So, he fulfilled scripture down to the very minute detail. And so it's amazing how God works like this. But can you imagine it? The King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the creator of this entire universe, is riding on this little old broken down borrowed animal. Just a little simple animal. He could have came riding in on a big white stallion. And that's what Jerusalem wanted. That's what the Jews wanted. They wanted their conqueror to come in riding on a white stallion to take over Rome and to set up his kingdom and all that. But he didn't come in that way. He came in just very humble, with great humility, on this little colt. The simple donkey, as mentioned right here, it represents humility. That's what that donkey represents. And though our Lord spoke the world into existence, he was humble. He was humble. And I noticed here that the animal was borrowed. You know, the Lord never owned anything. Never owned anything. I mean, the manger he was born in, the tomb he was buried in. He said he didn't even have a place to lay his head. And so he didn't own anything in his life. He didn't even own this animal that he goes and borrowed, even though he created it. That's almost hard to get your mind around. But he didn't own anything personally. He didn't take a lot of stock in stuff. Why do we take stock in stuff? You know, we get all worried about it. How we're going to managed to be able to buy this thing that we want. We get our eye on something. Yesterday, and I'm not saying anything bad about any of them, but we were giving out Easter baskets, and boy, they were going through looking at them baskets, you know. I'm going to make sure I get the right one, the one that's going to be make me the happiest. And I don't blame them. I would, too. I wasn't looking for them, but I'd have got the one guy. He got one that had a Nerf gun. And boy, he can load that thing up and shoot Nerf things across the building. That's one I would have picked. But we put a lot of stock in stuff. I mean, we work a job, not only provide for our family, but to what? Make ourselves more, have more things, you know, have a better car, have a better house, have better clothes, have better food to eat, and all this. We spend a lot of time worrying about all this little minute things down here when the Lord Jesus never put a single thought into any of that. He could care less for the things of this world. All he cared about was sharing the message of the gospel of salvation. But we see in the Bible that it tells us and warns us not to love the things of the world. It says, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If anyone love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And so we can get ourselves all caught up in the stuff and the things of the world and forget the big picture. And you know what? It scares me to death thinking about it. And I know we have a lot of things and things take priority in our lives. But when those things start becoming an idol in our life, we need to be very careful and we need to get rid of them. There was a time in my life where I thought collecting things was most important. I was a big NASCAR fan. Everybody knows it's no secret. I love Tony Stewart. I'm still mad because he retired. But I used to collect NASCAR memorabilia. And if you remember when we had the rummage sale, I sold everything that I had. I put it in that sale to give away. I don't remember what we was raising money for, the parking lot. We was raising money to pay the parking lot. And all those things I spent, there ain't no telling how much money I put into all that NASCAR memorabilia. And it meant entirely nothing. Nothing. And there come a time in my life when the Lord revealed to me, listen, you're putting too much thought, you're putting too much emphasis on stuff. You need to quit worrying about all that, and you need to focus on the things of me. And so we need to be very careful. We get all this stuff out of our minds. The Bible even says in Matthew 6:19, lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal, but lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. And so we find that our heart gets set on things instead of the Lord Jesus. And that's where we start messing up. Now, one thing you may not know about a colt is they're very hard to break. The colt, the Bible said, had never been ridden before. Now, I don't know if you've ever jumped on a colt that's never been ridden. Personally, I have. Let me tell you about it. I know I've told you before, but you listen again. Some of y'all might not have heard this. I was out blackberry picking. Me and Kevin, Brother Frank's son, we were out picking blackberries one time. Back up behind the house there in Maloneville. And there was this wild colt out there in the blackberry briars. Its hooves, it had been out there so long, its hooves were all curled up, you know, nobody took care of it. But it was just wild. It had briars and everything stuck in its wool and all. And I got the bright idea, you know what, I'm going to ride that thing. I want to ride that colt. And so we got to thinking, what in the world are we going to do? How are we going to do this? Well, this thing had never been took care of and apparently never been ridden. And so we got our blackberry bucket. We had a 5-gallon bucket. And we went over there very slowly and got behind it. It was eating in the grass. We put the 5-gallon bucket down. And I stepped up on that thing. And I slung my leg over. And I know more than got my leg over. And that thing shot off out of there like a rocket. I mean, it was like somebody had set it on fire. And we went through blackberry bushes. I was grabbing the mane, going up and down like this right here. And finally, that thing threw me right over the top of its head, smack dab in the middle of a big blackberry bush. And man, I come out of there picking blackberry thorns out of me and everything. And I would never, listen, kids, I advise you don't ever jump on a wild animal, okay? Don't ever do it. But the Lord Jesus, he finds this colt that's never been ridden. And he's riding on its back. Can you imagine this colt? Now listen, I know the Bible don't talk, well, it does talk about one animal speaking, but the Bible doesn't talk about animals being alive like they are on Walt Disney. But if that animal could speak today, can you imagine what he would say? Hey, the
King of Kings rode on my back. You may be a big stallion. I may not be anything, but the Lord Jesus rode me. What a testimony that animal could have had. You know, the Bible says if we don't cry out for the Lord Jesus, that the very rocks, he can make the rocks cry out. We need to always make sure we give glory and praise to God. But what a beautiful picture this must have been. You know, people, they always talk about how they'd like to go back and see such and such and maybe go back in time and see. I'd love to go back in time and be present there on that triumphal entry when the Lord Jesus came riding down from that. He's descending down off the Mount of Olives. He's going down that pathway, that roadway, up to the city of Jerusalem, which would have been going up. As he come riding down on that colt, can you imagine? And the throngs and multitudes of people that were all around there, we don't know how many there were. There were many, many people. There were so many people there that the Romans that were walking by thought that the whole world had gone after him. And so there were thousands upon thousands of people surrounding Jesus as he comes riding down that hill on that road on that little old donkey. He'd never been ridden before. I can just see that donkey smiling as he come down through there. And the Lord Jesus on his back. Friends, what a glorious scene that must have been. Look at it there in verse 6. And the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them, and brought the ass and the colt, and put on them their clothes, and they set him thereon. And a very great multitude spread their garments in the way. Others cut down branches from the trees and strawed them in the way. These branches right here mentioned in verse 8, these are branches of a palm tree. We see that over in the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verse 13. It says they were the branches of a palm tree. Now, the palm tree is considered a sacred tree, and it was used as a sign of triumphant. Back in the games, the Olympic games, when they play them, the winners, they would have palm branches. That was the sign that they were the conqueror. Constantine, the first Christian emperor, the Roman emperor Constantine, he had all of his coins engraved with his picture and palm leaves. And every emperor after that also did the same. It was a picture of winning. It's what it means. Winners were shouldered with palm branches. Even in everyday life, a lawyer, if he won a case, he would have a palm branch outside of his door showing that he won his case. And so this was very important to these people as a sign of victory. And when these people were going around throwing these palm branches down in the way of Jesus, they weren't trying to trip him up. They were showing that he was victorious, that he was the victor, he was the conqueror. And they were throwing those down, signifying that. In other words, what they were saying, and they may not even realize they were saying this, but you are our Messiah. You are our Savior is what they're trying to say right here. Hosanna, they're saying. In Sunday school class this morning over in Revelation chapter 7 and verse 9, we talked about this. And John was writing this down, and he was talking about seeing the great multitudes in heaven. Those that had been saved, those that had been brought out of the great tribulation period, and all the great multitude which no man could number. The Bible says this in Revelation chapter 7 verse 9, after this I beheld and lo a great multitude which no man could number of all nations and kindreds and people and tongues stood before the throne and before the Lamb clothed with white robes, listen, and palms in their hands. And cried with a loud voice, saying, salvation to our God, which sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb. So even there in the last days, back when we finally reach there, when we reach heaven, when we see everyone triumphing around Jesus and celebrating Jesus Christ, they're going to have palm branches in their hands showing that he is the victor. He's the Savior. He's the Messiah. He's Jesus. He's King. Isn't that going to be something? It's going to be something, friends. Verse 9 of our text says, and the multitudes that went before and that followed cried, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. By calling Jesus the Son of David here, they are actually proclaiming and owning and admitting that he is their Messiah. That's what they're saying by saying this. This is the usual title that the Messiah was known of. By the Jews, the son of David. They knew that's who it was going to be. And it says, crying and saying, Hosanna unto him. And this was done with loud acclamations so that everybody could hear it. They were giving him praise, honor, glory, blessing. And all this means they're wishing him prosperity, happiness, and victory. Jeremiah 23 and 5 says, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch. And a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth. In his day Judah shall be saved, and Israel shall dwell safely. And this is the name whereby he shall be called, the Lord our righteous.
And so even though these people there, as Jesus making his triumphal entry, even though they were singing and praising hosannas and calling him the victor, calling him the Messiah, the son of David, just a few days later, people would be crying out, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him. Verse 10 of our text says, and when he was come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved. You might want to underline that in your Bible. All the city was moved, saying, who is this? Friends, that might seem like a little simple statement right there, but it was not put in there as a filler in your Bible. God put that in there for a reason. God inspired these words to be written down. All the city was moved. Jesus made an impact on the entire city. This was a time, friends, of the Passover. This was the celebration time. This is when many millions of people would have been in Jerusalem. And the Bible says that Jesus caused all the city to be moved. I want to declare to you this morning that the name of Jesus will cause a reaction everywhere it's spoken. It may be a bad reaction on some people's part, but it will cause a reaction of some kind. I remember my dad saying one time he was teaching, and he said the mention of the name of Jesus will cause a reaction in some way. And that's the truth, friends. The name Jesus. People don't really care if you go around saying God. Even saying Lord doesn't bother most people. You can go and say a public prayer and use the name God, because that's what a lot of people call gods. Even Allah and Buddha and all those things, they call them their gods. But you start using the name Jesus, there's a reaction. The name Jesus, they want to strike it out of public speech. They don't want it to be heard. They don't want a prayer to be prayed in the name of Jesus. I'm so glad that our present administration, I'm not preaching politics, but our present administration actually proclaimed the name of Jesus during his inauguration. Friends, I want you to know it's important that we realize that we are a nation founded and based upon Christian morals and principles, and it's all pointed and directed toward the Lord Jesus. Jesus. We're not a Muslim nation. We're not any of those other nations. We are a Christian nation in the name of the Lord Jesus. It says all the city was moved. There was probably over 2 million people in that city at that time. There might have been more than that. I can imagine during the time of the Passover, all labor had stopped. There was not people working. It was all about the Passover. It was all about the celebration of the Jews. And, of course, they're talking about the time of Passover is when the Jews were let out of Egypt's bondage, but the Lord protected them. You remember they painted the doorposts with the blood of the Lamb, and the Lord overlooked them, and he did not cause them to die, and they were all able to get out. And they celebrate that time as looking back at the time that the death angel passed over them and saved them. And so they celebrated that heavily. And so they wouldn't work, they wouldn't do certain things. And so during that time when Jesus is coming in, this triumphal entry, with all these thousands of people flocking around him and screaming out hosannas, throwing down palm branches, and this big old thing coming through, all the city was in some way affected. And they said, who is this? Imagine that. The Savior of the world comes riding into your city and you say, who is this? Who is this? I want you to know today we can go and tell this world about the name of Jesus. And you know what it's going to cause them to do? Who is this? Who is this Jesus? You know, being raised here in the good old South, in the buckle of the Bible Belt, we always think everybody went to church and everybody knows who Jesus is. Friends, it ain't that way anymore. I hear people all the time come and tell me, I was talking to a guy the other day and said something about Jesus, and he said he'd never heard that name before. He didn't know who that was. Here, where we live, people don't know who Jesus is. We need to proclaim that Jesus is the Savior. He's the one that saves men from their sins, and it's going to cause a reaction of some kind. Who is this? As the Savior of the world comes riding up into the city, and all the city is moved, and they're all saying, who is this? And so they're all screaming, who is this? Who's this guy down? Who's this guy on this donkey? Who is this riding in? Who is this they're all screaming about? And so the word's going to start spreading. This is Jesus, Jesus of Nazareth. The one, you know, the prophet, the one that came and did the miracles and was teaching in our temples and doing all these things. This is Jesus. And so the whole city is on uproar and they're all trying to figure out what's going on. I want you to know, friends, even though the light of the world is here, even though we have Jesus and he can be our light, men still are in darkness today, and they don't know the light. They don't know this Jesus. And so we have to tell them. And so, it, you know, even in the tribulation period, which we've been talking about again in Sunday school, sorry. But in Sunday school, we've been talking about the tribulation period. Even in that time period, seeing everything that's going to take place and knowing that all the prophecies of the Bible and everything that all the churches and preachers have been preaching all these years has come true, there will still be people that will refuse to believe in Jesus. And that's hard to wrap our minds around. But that's the truth. That's what's going to happen. Verse 11, it said, "And the multitude said, this is Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee." They'd been watching and waiting for this moment all of their lives. Every Jew alive, they knew this was the moment they had been waiting on. God had promised them a Savior, a Messiah, the Son of David, your Savior. And they've all been looking for it. Over in Deuteronomy 18:18, Moses said, "I will raise them up a prophet from among their brethren like unto thee, and will put my words in his mouth, and he shall speak unto them all that I shall command him." Moses didn't say it. God said it. Moses wrote it down there in Deuteronomy. And he's saying, I'm sending one here. This is him. He sent him. They've all been waiting and looking for him. And here he is in front of them. And they say, it's Jesus, the prophet of Nazareth of Galilee. And I find it ironic that they're yelling Hosanna in the highest and calling him a prophet. But in a few days later, they're saying, crucify him. Crucify him. Crucify him. You know, that's the way people are today. As long as the preacher's preaching about health, wealth, prosperity, things that make you happy, telling you that you're a great person and you're beautiful, oh, there's no problem with that. That preacher, he's going to get a lot of attention. He's going to get a lot of amens. He's going to get a lot of agreements. But when you start getting down on the sin, when you start calling out what the Bible calls sin, and you quit preaching about fuzzy bunnies and jelly beans and all this, and you start dwelling on the righteousness of Jesus Christ, the blood that was shed, the command to turn from our sins and turn to Jesus to save us, that's not a popular message. It's not a popular message. But people are just like they were in that day, fickle. My question this morning is, do you recognize Jesus as your Savior? Do you recognize him as your Lord? As your Lord and Master? Is he the Lord of your life? Now, there's a big controversy going around in a lot of Baptist churches of people preaching Lordship salvation. And people want to know, what's Lordship salvation? What's that mean? Lordship salvation simply means if you've been saved, you're going to make the Lord Jesus the Lord of your life. That's what it means. It doesn't mean you're preaching something outside of the trueness of the gospel. The gospel is that we're saved by grace through faith, and we trust the Lord Jesus to save us. But if you can trust the Lord to save you of your sins, you can guarantee you can trust him to rule and reign in your life. If you can't make the Lord Jesus the Lord of your life, then he's not your Lord at all. You'll have the desire to make him your Lord. You can't tell me, yeah, I'm going to go and trust Jesus my Savior, and then I'm just going to live any old jolly way I want to because I'm saved by grace. No, that's not what the Bible teaches. The Lord says that you'll be his disciple. That you will take up your cross and follow him daily. That you will make him the Lord of your life. Jesus is very clear about it. Luke 14:27, whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. Jesus told the rich young ruler, remember the rich young ruler come to him, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And he kept telling him he'd done all these things. He kept all the commandments. He'd done this, he'd done that. And the Lord told him that he needed to take up the cross and follow him. Sell all you have and give it to the poor and take up your cross and follow me. And he walked away sad. Why? He didn't want to make the Lord Jesus the Lord of his life. In Matthew 16:24, Jesus, talking to his disciples, said, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. The Lord Jesus must be the Lord of your life, or he's not your Lord at all. We trust in him to save us. We trust in him to keep us. We trust in him to walk with us daily. There's too much weak preaching going on these days. Preachers claiming you can say a little prayer, 1, 2, 3, repeat after me, raise your hand if you want to be saved. Friends, that's not salvation. Salvation is when you know You need the Lord Jesus to save you. You're a miserable, rotten, dirty sinner. You're going to go to hell, and you need Jesus to save you. You trust in his finished work on the cross. And by grace, the grace of God, who allows you to be saved. God allows you to be saved. It's all through him. You didn't do a thing to be saved. God saved you. You can't save yourself. And it's simply by having that faith that he will save you. Listen, if you've truly been saved, you will desire to continue living the same way that Jesus wanted to live. You won't try to mock him. They called them Christians there in Antioch, little Christos, those that imitated and mocked Christ. That's what we want to be, little imitators of Christ. And if we don't have that desire, I've got to question, do we really have the new creature in us? Have we truly been saved? Now, I know I've been talking about Palm Sunday and about the Lord's triumphal entry and all that, and it's true, but I know the Bible teaches us that we're to preach salvation. We're to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ until the Lord comes again, until he raptures us out of here, until he sums everything up, until he comes back like it talks about there on the Mount of Olives and makes this place right again. It's our duty to tell people about Jesus. And friends, if you're saved today, that ought to be your desire, to tell people about Jesus. I want them to come get the invitation song this morning. I want us to stand today, and I want to pray. And as I'm praying, if the Lord Jesus has been speaking to you, if the Holy Spirit's been convicting your heart that you need to be saved today, would you make your way down to this altar and let me pray with you? Let me show you in the Bible what it talks about being saved. And let's get things right today. If you're backslidden, if you need to get close to the Lord again, would you come down? Throw all those down at the Lord's feet and say, Lord, take it from me. Lord, put me back where I need to be and being walking with you faithfully. But if you have a need today, as I pray, I want you to come down to this altar. Heavenly Father, I come to you this morning, Lord. I've done all I can do. Lord, it's not my job to convict hearts. Lord, it's my job to just tell people what the Bible says, what you say. And God, now I'm trusting in you, Lord. If there's one here that needs to come down to this altar this morning and repent of their sins, turn their life over to you, God, whatever it may take to rededicate their life, whatever they need today, Lord, I'm trusting in you, Lord, to convict their heart and show them that need today before it's too late. Help us today, Father. Lord, we love you. We thank you, God, for riding up into that triumphal entry into Jerusalem, God, and for the things you did after that, Lord. Without that, we could not be saved. But Lord, if there's one here that needs help, would you lead them to this altar? In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.